The idea of automating a CPE collection. I only have two certifications and I know how annoying it is for the CPEs. And I like the idea of keeping it simple. Like I was waiting for some kind of announcement how blockchain is going to change the world of the cloud. And it's starting small and you're keeping it simple and I like it. Good luck with the road. And good luck with that. Our next speaker, first of all, he basically deserves a big round of applause because he was sitting here all day asking questions and writing comments. So thank you, Olaf. You definitely get the badge for being the most determined listener today. Olaf, ABN AMRO, one of the biggest banks in the world, and Olaf is here to talk to us about how they adopt cloud in his bank. Good luck, Olaf. Thank you.
Thank you, Moshe. Well, one of the biggest banks in the world. I think we used to be that, but we're a lot smaller now, but I'll tell you more about it. Okay, maybe just to introduce myself for those who don't know me, I'm Olaf Steutker. I'm a strategic advisor in the Corporate Information Security Office in ABN AMRO Bank. And it is indeed a big bank, but it's the top 25 of the European banks. So it's, I would say, not the biggest bank in the world. More about myself, I'm an active member of the Cloud Security Alliance Financial Services Working Group. Also a member of ISF, Information Security Forum, and the FSISEC, the financial services industry. And that's also where we learn to collaborate, because collaboration, that's what it's all about. Today I'm going to share your story about our Octagon model. And actually yesterday we found out that the name should be changed, because yesterday Damir and Tim, who's going to be after me in a speech, visited and had the opportunity to visit Jerusalem. And we went up to Temple Mount and saw also the dome on the mountain, Temple Mount, with the big golden dome. And it became clear that it was built by the Byzantine architects. And the Byzantine architects, they use an octagon model to create their temple. So actually, it should be called the Byzantine model, I think, from now on. So. Having said that, I'll tell you a little bit about the bank. What I said is the top 25 bank in Europe, 400 billion total assets. We have about 20,000 employees currently, and actually the numbers are going down because of automation. That's clear, eh? All the offices are being transformed into electronic offices, and we have a lot of people in the head office environment, but not so many anymore in the real offices. I don't know how it is here. And we do affect all types of banking, so both retail and corporate banking. We do have a global presence, although what I said in the old days, and that's about 10 years ago when we were demerged, we had about 70 countries that we were in, and then we were a 100,000 employee company, so we really have changed over time. But we're still a global bank working from the Netherlands. Then on the story itself, and this is actually the head office in Amsterdam. And I have to give credits to Jim de Haas, who was supposed to be here to do the talk, the lecture, but luckily he gave me the opportunity. But Jim de Haas is working on a white paper that is also available via the CSA website. I think it's open for comments because it's still a draft. Oh, it's published. Actually, yeah, it's published, so you can read about it. So if you want to know more about this later on, please find out on the website. Then something about our situation with respect to cloud usage. And actually, we have gone through the journey ourselves, of course, also over the last decade. And as we are a bank, we are very traditional. And we have our, let's call it the center, how you call it, data center. Our local data center on site is in Amstelveen, very close to Amsterdam. And we have IBM as our working partner. So we first, our first thoughts about going to the cloud was actually not really going into the cloud, but creating our own cloud. So we have an IBM cloud on-premise, which is in the data center. And we call that the cloud. But the reality, of course, is that the public cloud, that is really offering much more flexibility. And we couldn't do without it. And that's also why we have also chosen for both Azure and AWS as also public cloud environments. And actually, we see now that we have these three environments as more or less our IT infrastructure, our base IT infrastructure for the future. But next to that, we also have the SaaS environment. And I'm not sure about how it is with your companies, but SaaS is a different animal. Because if you look at the Amazon and Azure world, it's about developing your own products. But SaaS is about buying something with your credit card, or if you do it in a thorough way, more in a joint effort, and then making it work. Well, that's also something that we have been doing over the last 10 years. And actually, it started already before we actually knew it. So we were already putting things into SaaS solutions without even knowing it would should have been called a SaaS solution. And we started off with some HR partnerships, and then we went to also some Salesforce local implementations. And even with the traditional core banking environment, we do have SaaS implementations, because we also make, we also partner up with startups. We also have local challenger banks, as they called in the Netherlands, which are more or less subsidiaries of the bank that offer specific solutions to clients in a much more flexible way. So we create more or less our own competition by creating those challenger banks that are fully cloud-based. And you see that if you put this in place, that also requires some thought about, okay, but how are we going to govern this? Because simply putting things in the cloud, that's maybe not the wisest thing to do without knowing about it. And actually, we also have a problem that we are heavily regulated. So the regulators ask us to show evidence of what made us make that, the choice and the decision to go into the cloud. Now, that's how we come into the this challenges that we are facing. I mean, actually, this is one of the first challenges that we see that what we call the second line parties. It's more or less the, I don't know if you heard about the three lines of defense model. Is that known here or not? But it's first line is like the business, the first line responsibility for actual business. Second line is about, let's say, the more risk-oriented functions, risk compliance, legal, etc. And the third line is more audit. Well, we have a fourth line, which is the regulator, and so on and so on. So they all have their say in making those decisions, but actually, do they know what they're talking about, and do they know what they're going to approve? And also, we see that there's a lot of developments going on with the regulations, and that's, I think it was mentioned a few times already today. It is also for us, of course. The Dutch national regulator is really keen on, let's say, allowing banks to go ahead, but then in a controlled way. So they want to make sure that they have some governance around it, and they ask you to show the evidence. We see also the technological developments going on. And then we see some other stuff that, are we able to keep up with the technologies developments and then know what to do from a control perspective? So you see all these kind of challenges, and actually, while all these things are happening, the landscape is growing. We have now hundreds, or maybe even more than 200 SaaS implementations already in the bank, all niche. So it's not, let's say, that our complete banking infrastructure is totally in the cloud yet. But we do have them in place, and they are there, and they're not going away. So, and that's only about how to make the decision about going into the cloud, and then still we have to continue monitoring it. I think it also was mentioned by you. We have to continue monitoring it and make sure that we stay in, on top of it going forward, and that we prove to the regulators that we do the right thing. Of course, we do have those frameworks that are known to all of you that are there. So the ISO framework, NIST frameworks, they give good hands on how to deal with it. But in practice, it makes it very difficult to translate into practical work. So if I talk about the second line responsibilities, they don't have a clue if they look at this kind of models, because that's not their language. So, and then say furthermore, we also have our own development teams that are also changing their world. We have agile working is coming up everywhere. So even in the IaaS and PaaS environment, we also do have a lot of changes happening. And we see that teams are changing so rapidly that we ourselves also have a problem to keep up with from a security and a compliance perspective. So, having said that, the question is how to deal with those challenges. And actually, we do have, of course, a lot of help available with all the material that's out there, but we also think we should get our head around it and make it more practical. So that's why we come up with the cloud model and the Octagon model, and it actually it is a derivative of the original thoughts that we were already presented 10 years ago. I think CSA was adopting the Jericho model at that time. I think it was even created by some of you. I'm not sure about. So we see, we looked at this model, but actually the model is not, let's say, doesn't give enough possibilities to really look at it. So it is a good start, but it's not good enough. Because if you really think about it, there's also other things that are playing a role. So what's the type of data that you're going to use? What is the global presence? So it's location, data location. It's also the way it is translated in a practical way. So we thought that we should look at it in a more in a different way and look at other options to make the translation. And that's how we come up with the Octagon model. And actually, you should look at it as a model that gives you a few lenses or ways to look at your data and look at the decisions that you're going to take. And we adopted this, we created this more or less as a help for the second line parties to do their work. And I'll tell you more about it in a second, because that's what we said, the goal is first and foremost to help the second line parties to understand what they're doing. Yeah? If you're from compliance, from legal, from risk, and you don't know much about the cloud, this is a way to learn about it and look at the different instances from different angles. And it also gives you an opportunity to keep up with the challenges during the projects that you're into. Because if you really look at it, if you adopt a SaaS solution, then it's not a one-time effort to accept and to judge that SaaS solution, but you should be doing it all time long. So it's more like an ongoing process, and by using these different angles, you will help yourself in getting your head around it. Okay, I'll tell you more about the model in detail, and I will just look at the examples, because then I don't have to turn my back on you every time, and just run through them one by one. So the first one is about data classification. For the bank, data is key. Data is the core. And I think from a security perspective, we all know that the CIA triad is there and still there to stay. So confidentiality, integrity, availability as a starting point for data classification is what should be agreed in all occasions. And what we see is that it is sometimes difficult to get a good decision about the CIA classification itself. It's not so clear how sensitive the data is, because if you do not really reward it in the proper way, then you do maybe the different things and you make the wrong decision. So the first question that we have, and first item is, make sure that you have the data classification as such done in a proper way and also agreed across your team. Another one is that it should be aligned. I think we talked about already the different applications that are linked to each other, and if you have of course a connection to other applications, then the strongest classification should apply to the whole chain, because you want to make sure that the data classification is valid for the whole chain. Then the second perspective is about countries, and I think we also mentioned it a few times today, that we have the country perspective that is important, especially from a legal side or from a compliance side. The country's perspective is very valid, and it goes both for the hosting country, it goes for the country where you are using the data, and you should take that perspective into account. And also what you could do is, and that's specifically also on the legal side, make sure that you have proper monoclauses in place in your legal contracts. And if you know in what country you are, you can also apply those very easily. And I think that perspective will help also in the discussions. So knowing what country you're working on is good for the assessment itself. Then the procurement side or contracting side. I think that was also mentioned already today. Getting divorced is sometimes more easy than getting rid of your SaaS supplier or your cloud supplier. Well, actually, we do understand that very well. And I would almost say that you should not even start that marriage before you actually know how to get rid of it. I'm not saying that if you should do that when you get married personally, but especially when you do a cloud contract, I think that is really important to think about. And actually, from a regulatory point of view, that is one of the requirements that we also have to deal with. We have to even prove at this moment how we will do an exit from a cloud provider. Subcontracting, I think it was also mentioned already today a few times, but it is definitely one of the most important things to understand how subcontractors are related to the cloud provider that you're using. And actually also here the regulations play a role for us because we are now asked to report on the subcontractors being used by our cloud provider. Can you imagine how much work that is to really keep that data up and available? So that's really something that we also, I think, should get our head around. Now then IT governance as a fourth angle. I think it's important to have focus on all kind of IT areas, and data leakage is just one example of that. But do you have contracts in place that will have data leakage agreements with the cloud provider? Do you get reports on it? I think also having the data reported to you, is that part of your SIEM solution? I don't know. Single sign-on, I think we have the CASB functionality as a, let's say, as a potential solution or a solution, but do you have that in place? And is it working with every single SaaS provider? Then architecture. I think this is also one of the things that we are faced with in our bank, is that because it's so easy to buy cloud solutions, especially on the SaaS one I'm now talking about, we sometimes come to the conclusion that they have bought a solution already before really thinking about it from an architecture perspective. And of course, that is not what we want, so why not make sure that that they all go first look at the overall architecture picture before making this kind of decisions. And for us, that's again, I'm now talking from the things that we want to learn to our teams to make sure that they have thought about this. Development engineering, this is of course specifically on the DevOps environment, and it's effect only for the IaaS and PaaS environment, so the Amazon Azure environments. Do make sure that you make use of secure development pipelines, that you have only secure software running in your cloud from that sense. Make sure that your DevOps team has a maturity. Make use of certifications. Make sure that your team is certified for the job. And then I think last two, the chain of service providers, so chain transparency. I think I already mentioned it from a procurement point of view, but I think it is important that you have a clear view on how subcontractors are linked to the service providers and also how they are linked to each other. And also, I think it was also mentioned today, site survey data. It's very difficult to get that data in place, if not impossible. But you should make have a thought about it and should make arrangement for it, at least from also, again, regulatory point of view. We should prove what is allowed and if there's site inspection allowed whenever necessary. Now, last one, risk processes. These are just two examples. But most importantly, do make sure that the normal standard risk processes are in place also for cloud solutions. That's more or less what we should do. All right. Now, you may ask yourself the question, is this now something new? Because we already have seen this, and this is something that probably is also available via all the tools that we already have. Cloud Security Alliance have the CCM matrix and all kind of other elements are there. But actually for us, it's a way to help educate our own people and get their head around and make sure that they do the right things, so that they do the right requirement selection, that they think about cloud solutions, the cloud solutions, risk decision making in the right way, and that they really learn about this kind of risks. And that does not mean that you have to do something different in the sense that you create another framework as such, but that you integrate the information that you already have and put it into this kind of discussions. And that makes it easy to use it then on top of it, and also, I already said this more or less, to make them more complete. And what is for us was the best part of the knowledge is that you can also use it for awareness purposes in your team, so as a learning experience. And actually, we really did it in practice. And I don't know to what extent there are Tolkien fans here in the room, but we really believe that it is learning by doing. And actually, this is not a game that gives you awareness as such. It's a learning game where you learn what to do and what to do, how to do the right thing. And we really put it more or less into practice, educating people and make them aware. And of course, not cloud security experts, and they will not be at the end, but they will know what to do and how to do the right things. And just as the game dynamics, and that's, I think, also good to mention, it is something that you can play in a, let's say, board game way with cases that we offer to you. So we have more or less cases and solutions, but you can also do it in real life with a real SaaS decision process that's at the table at that moment. And I would say once the people get more experience in doing this kind of assessments, they also know what lenses they should look at and what to do right. And just for practical reasons, we offer this even as a game to play. You can opt for a game if you want to learn it. You can do it with your team. And actually, if you would be interested, we can also do it with you. I didn't bring the games yet, but I know that in CSA we have done it before, so we can do it also in chapter sessions. Okay, this is more or less about the content of the Octagon model. I just have a few more slides that's more on the general governance that we have in place, because I think what it all comes down to is that we use this Octagon model to get better risk assessments and better risks decision making. But actually, we also have, let's say, governance internally in the bank arranged to really make that practice, make it more practical. And we call that the Cloud Approval Board. And actually, it is also it's more or less backed up by the cloud policy that we have put in place. And we play a gatekeeper role for decision making on cloud instances. Myself, I'm also a member of the Cloud Approval Board. So what we do then is more or less we ratify the assessments that are being made by the different groups on cloud decision making. And then it's to make sure that we have done the right quality. And it's not so much about redoing the actual, let's say, decision about whether or not to go into the cloud, but it's really about, did we do the right thing? Did we do the right assessments? Did we look at every angle? And then also report to the regulator, because that's, again, from the banking sector, we do have heavy regulations, and we are obliged to also report every single cloud instance individually. What you see is that you have, in fact, everyone on the table, so it's chaired by the CISO department, or the Corporate Information Security Officer, and we have the second line functions and the business functions together having this discussion, and it really helps to get a head around, do we do the right things and do we do it in the right way? And just as a last one, it's also on the support that you need. We have a team that's really working on it, effectively one FTE effort, but we do make sure that we offer proper support for let's say, the bank in doing the right things, and that's how we do it. I think this is more or less it. Any questions at this moment? Yeah? The real answer is everybody should be educated about cloud security. So the development teams themselves, that if you are really in an IaaS PaaS environment and you do the development themselves, so you work in the cloud, and we use the Amazon certification program, for instance, to make sure that people know how to work in Amazon environment or the Azure environment. But this is on the what we call the second line functions, so risk, legal, compliance, IT, that make the decisions about whether or not to go into the cloud. And we do want to make sure that the teams that are working on this, more or less have this knowledge. Yeah, you want to go back? Yeah. Oh, ORM is operational risk management. Architecture, legal, compliance, corporate information security office, business representatives, audit and IT. It's more like the infrastructure people, so the people that own the cloud, more or less. So the cloud infrastructure. Yeah. Now the point is that because we are heavily regulated, we're obliged to do the reporting to the regulator, and we need a channel to make that happen. And this board is more or less the gatekeeper for the bank to make that happen. So that's from an organization perspective. From a technical perspective, we of course have monitoring in place. So we see what is happening. We have a CASB running, so we can also see cloud access for non-approved applications or environments, because it's just normal internet traffic. And then we can act upon it and find out what's the reason why it is used, etc. So we do, for instance, on the CASB, we do certain investigate certain use cases on cloud usage that have not gone through the approval process. Yeah. Other questions? No. If not, thank you very much.